So back-to-back session, it made sense. You know, I was worried about presenting two sessions, but it kind of makes sense that, okay, I'm getting it over with in one go rather than, okay, having to worry about another session tomorrow. So thanks again for coming for this one. We, in the earlier session, we talked about the CI/CD parts of all of this, and now we are going to look at the infrastructure side of things with Terraform. So again, that's me, but I thought that, okay, I shouldn't really use the same photograph, so I used this photograph, which is from Bristol, from last week, sorry, this week, earlier this week. Went on a very short trip, and this was like, you know, we took an Uber to go to this, like, you know, take us to this bridge. Somebody recommended that I should go to this bridge, so we went there, and we were looking for something to eat as well, and you know, it was all confusing, and then the driver waited for us for about 10 minutes while we quickly ran through the bridge and came back, and we then went for lunch. Anyway, it was fun. I'm Hussain. I am a director of Drupal practice at Accelerant and a contributor to the Drupal ecosystem since a few years. Let's talk about this session, you know, where I said, you know, how do we build infrastructure? So what's the challenge of building infrastructure? First thing, it should be effective. We want to be, we want to stay updated with all the current trends in infrastructure technology. And as you know, it moves fast right now. AWS, for example, releases a new product to market. I don't know how often, but like kind of works out to every week or even every day. They kind of release 100 products a year. So I'm not saying that we have to use all of that, but we have to keep up with trends to make sure that we are using the right tool available for the job. On the tech stack side, and I'm not talking about infrastructure now, but on the tech stack, you know, the solution that you're building, it has to be effective for the same reason. You know, for example, JavaScript frameworks are moving at an even faster pace, if that's possible. You have new framework, that's a common joke, right? I don't need to say that again. Common joke that you have a framework every week. Probably true. And not so anymore, right? I think it's stabilizing right now, but yeah, you know, things move fast in the JavaScript world. Best practices keep changing. You have to stay, you have to stay with the trend of what's happening. And the reason you have to stay with the trend is not hype. It's because so that your team can work and your team can grow with that, with the program that you have written. The second challenge that we face is content. And now this is more to do with the specific project as well. But apart from the technology that you use to build, you know, your content also needs to be. You should be able to design content the way you need it, and that includes all of Drupal's features, you know, rich content modeling capabilities like paragraphs and media, and like lot of all of these things. And we want all of these things, but we also want to keep cost in our picture. So this is the challenge. This is, you know, we have to keep, like, it's just a constant balancing game, you know, getting all of these to work together to achieve your goal. And the goal is, or this is more of a solution, not a goal, you know. So the challenge that we faced was building infrastructure for a multi-site decoupled Drupal installation using Terraform. let's break it up. Drupal, I already mentioned. Drupal is, I think you would agree that it's a pretty good system for managing content. It has a rich content structure. You can define as many content types as you would like. You have paragraphs and other mechanism of structured content. And layout as well. Now with layout builder, you don't need to rely on paragraphs for that either. Content moderation is pretty powerful in Drupal. I think still one of the reasons why Drupal continues to be relevant today in the enterprise space. So this project was for a major corporate in hospitality industry. I can't name names here, NDAs and stuff. But this is a very major player in hospitality industry. And of course, you know, you need support for rich content, structured content and all that. Media handling, like I said. The next thing is decoupling. And this has to do with, you know, what I said about effective earlier. Drupal is great for content and catching up, let's say catching up on the front end side of things. So the obvious choice for us to build this whole, I mentioned in my last presentation, but I didn't mention it now. But we built like five or six different websites of a single Drupal backend. And it made sense for us to go the decoupled route because each of the websites, even though the content was similar, which is why we have the same backend for all of these websites. The backend was similar, the front ends are entirely different. So decoupled made sense. You know, we didn't have to worry about multiple themes and, like, you know, wrangling all of those things together. And it made sense. The teams that were responsible for coming up with design, they have their own workflow, their own schedule. And I think that's one of the powers of a decoupled approach to building Drupal websites. You know, I'll talk about this again later. In this case, we used Angular, TypeScript, and Drupal as an API-first service, which is, of course, what Drupal is good at. Drupal 8, you know, when we were building Drupal 8, we often said that Drupal is a first-class CMS built on a first-class API server. It allowed Steam to work independently. Again, we'll talk more about this. And I think someone asked a question about this, you know, how do you do this test? And, like, no, we started by defining an API contract, which we hope to use in tests. We didn't get around to that, but yeah. Next thing is multi-site. And now this is more to do with the cost part of, you know, what we discussed earlier. It reduces the total cost because now even though you have six websites, six different front ends, you still have only one backend. And multi-site is a decent way to approach this problem. And Acquia Site Factory allows spinning up new sites on demand. You know, you don't have to need developer involvement to, if you want to spin up a new site on your multi-site installation, ACSF takes care of that for you. And the last thing, you know, infrastructure, because of course the website has to live somewhere, right? Finally, Terraform, because creating infrastructure by using a mouse and keyboard is, I don't know, 2010, yes. So infrastructure as code, that's a very common paradigm right now. Terraform is not the only thing that does it, but I think it's one of those tools that do it well. If you're purely AWS, what is that? CloudFormation is a good candidate if you're purely on AWS. Over here, we are, like I said in the last session also, it was not just AWS, we were also on Allium. And I believe there are other things that are coming up, but I think still, Terraform is one of the most widely used and most widely supported tool for different providers. Idempotent. Idempotent is, you might have heard of this idempotency in Ansible maybe. And basically what it means is that, how do I put that? So whatever you create, your script defines that perfectly. Perfectly is, I know it's a too strong of a word, but yeah, there's a one-to-one mapping about, like, you know, what the module is supposed to do, or what the tool is supposed to do with your module. And if an action doesn't need to be run, it doesn't run, basically. I'm forgetting the dictionary meaning of idempotency, so forgive me. So when we talk about decoupled websites, there are two primary areas we talk about, backend and the frontend, of course. In our case, it was more like this. We had one Drupal instance and multiple Angular frontends, you know. And this was, again, at the time of when we were building it. Later, we added new sites. And some of the things that characterize this is that Drupal was built using a multi-site approach. It was not a single content, so it was not a single site where you classified content and each site would pick up different content. It was rather six different Drupal installations, essentially, but it was a single code base. In other words, your typical multi-site. And each Angular frontend was served off an S3 bucket or an Alione OSS bucket. So there is no server runtime as such. You know, your HTML is just in a bucket and it gets served exactly as it is, which means that when Angular is talking to Drupal, it needs to know the correct API endpoint. And you know, there are multiple environments, multiple clouds. So an Angular frontend on Alione in dev environment for a particular, for let's say site one, should only talk to site one's dev environment on Drupal multi-site. So that, which is why we needed to have multiple build stages for each environment, which we talked about in the last session. So the way it all came together, the information flow, so to speak, of the entire front end looks something like this. So you have the visitor, and you know, you're going to this website, something.com, and it. So this is this example is for AWS, but Alione is very, very similar because, like I said, Alione is like, you know, it offers similar products that AWS does. It sometimes changes some of the mechanisms, but essentially, like, the broadly it's the same. You know, like, for example, API gateway. There is an API gateway kind of service in Alione as well. So in terms of AWS, whenever the visitor requests a website, like a site.com, it hits the CDN, and if it is not cached on the edge, it goes to the S3 bucket, where you have all the Angular app and the static assets, you know, the icons and stuff like that. So if it is already in the cache in CDN, it directly sends it back. Now the interesting thing happens, that, you know, now the visitor has the HTML and it starts to work with it. And, like, of course, you know, when you're rendering the HTML file, you have things like scripts and CSS files and images and everything, right? Now, all of these CSS scripts and all of those they're simple. They follow the same route because they're all static. They're all stored in the S3 bucket. So it's the same flow for loading all the static assets. But then you get to the API. And the API is also served on the same domain in many cases. At least in AWS case, yes, it is served on the same domain. So when visitor makes an API call, so the Angular app now requests Drupal for content. And our main concern here is performance. With CDN, the HTML files are cached at edge, which is great. But if you're going to hit your Drupal server for content, you're not really gaining any performance advantage because the HTML may load, but then it waits for the data. That becomes a bottleneck. So of course, we want to bring that at edge as well. So our architecture was that the visitor, whenever requests an API, again it goes to the CDN, which, if it is not cached, sends it to API gateway, which in turn sends it to Lambda function. And API gateway, because Lambda function, you cannot directly invoke it with you know, on HTTP. I don't know if that's changed, by the way, but at the time you couldn't. So you need an API gateway in front of it. And the reason we have this is, well, let me come to that. And of course, the Lambda function then directly invokes the Drupal backend. And the idea is that whatever request, whatever response Drupal sends, it gets cached at the CloudFront layer, the CDN layer. right? So now you have cached output of API as well. Now API gateway has something like, you know, you can just mirror content. You know, you don't really need this Lambda function. But in this case, we do need it because Drupal would generate content with its own internal URLs. And now, of course, we can customize it so that Drupal would modify the URLs before it sends it. But then Drupal has to start understanding all the different URLs and the mappings to the real world URLs. Right, it's a decoupled system, right? Drupal is not on the same, like if it is site.com, Drupal, it might be something like dev-site-acquiesce-site-factory.com, something like that. That's not the URL scheme, but something like that. So this Lambda function replaces all of those strings, goes through the response, replaces all of these strings, these URLs, and sends it back to the visitor. It goes through CDN, which means it gets cached at CDN. And the final part of the equation is image assets, as in the content, which is the user-generated content, not the static assets. And again, we want to bring that to edge. So it follows the same process. The path is not changed, but you know, Drupal stores all the images in site's default files directory, right? So like that's how CDN distinguishes that. Okay, this is an actual user image, not a static image. So anything with an Acquia site factory, we have sites/g/files, not default. So anything with that prefix goes directly to the image assets. I think that's about it from the visitor point of view. And the editorial staff, they would directly use the Drupal servers. That's not a... I mean, of course, they had their own layer of IP whitelisting and all that, which made this whole thing challenging for us because this was blocked on IPs, and you don't know what IPs CDNs are going to request from, right? So it made it a little tricky, but we got around that, out of scope for this thing. So this is what we needed to build, you know, what we saw. And we decided that we have to follow infrastructure as code, and Terraform was an obvious choice. Like it says, you know, it enables you to safely and predictably create, change, and improve infrastructure. And the idea was that we knew that we're not going to get it right on the first attempt. You know, we don't know, like, you know, things, requirements change, right? Even if we knew what we were building, requirements change constantly. And like I mentioned earlier, we were really building like 24 or 28 different websites. So this entire thing that you saw, this whole configuration had to be repeated 28 times. AWS and like, you know, some on AWS, mostly on AWS, but some on Alun as well. So infrastructure as code is obvious. Really, it's not practical to do all of this manually. So Terraform is, has anyone come across Terraform before? Most have, right? So I don't need to tell what Terraform is. You know, it's a HashiCorp tool, and you write files like, let's go to this. Yeah, so you have infrastructure as code, which you already said. You have an opportunity to plan your changes, so it's not going to blindly just change everything without giving you an opportunity to verify that, okay, only the approved changes can go through. So basically a plan, and then create infrastructure as per plan. Not like you can design an approval workflow. We didn't need all of this in our case. The architecture that I showed you, it's not too complex. You know, we needed a few resources to bring all of it together. We managed to build all of it in a single module, like one module for AWS and one for Alun. Not terribly complex, but in cases where it does get complex, you do have an opportunity, you know, like how you have code reviews for your code before it gets merged in. You can have a code review for the plan, not the Terraform script, but you don't really know what exactly is going to happen. You can code review the plan itself. So this is what a Terraform module looks like. You know, I shouldn't say it is a script because it is not a scripted approach. It's where you define things, not tell it to do things. In this example, you know, I'm creating a resource called resource of type AWS S3 bucket, giving it a name. You know, so we have a different bucket for logs. We have a bucket for the files itself, but then we have another bucket for logs. And we specify a few things, you know, like the bucket name, the ACL for that, which region do you want it in, and other things like, you know, we need encryption for that. And then we have many of these providers, they support this thing called tags. So in AWS, you can classify all resources using tags, and that helps in billing and everything. So it's a good idea to always use tags so that you can always find resources. One of the tags I always put is this Terraform is true, so that it indicates that this particular resource was created with Terraform. So this is, it's not really JSON, but it was inspired by JSON. And it's modified so that you don't really need to keep it as verbose as possible. You know, like, you know, JSON gets very verbose. If you have seen Composer JSON files or Package JSON files, you know what I mean. Compared to that, this is a lot more readable, right? So it was modified to make the code much more readable, and it is saved as a .tf file. Main purpose is to declare resources, right? One interesting thing about this is, so this format is called HCL, and it is compatible with JSON. So if you want to, for example, if you want to machine generate this code or whatever you call this, if you want to generate it as a machine, you don't need to write it like this. You can actually generate it as JSON and pass it on. Terraform can read that as well because they are essentially compatible. There is a representation, you know, I will not go too deep into it, but there is an equivalent representation of this entire thing in JSON, like a resource node, and then under that you have an AWS S3 bucket key and so on. There is an equivalent representation. Okay, so so next comes the planning part. You know, you have written your Terraform code similar to that, and now you come to the planning stage of your infrastructure. You would run this command Terraform plan or Terraform graph. So Terraform graph would, you know, like in the background, you can see, not very clear, but you can see this thing in the background, right? It produces output like that. And this, you can use this to represent your entire infrastructure. This graph is actually from our example itself. It's not like just some graph I found. It's actually the, what we built in this particular project. And you can see that, you know, even for a relatively simple thing, you know, the graph gets really difficult to read. And the idea is that, you know, okay, yeah, you can use this graph output to read and understand what things are, but you would usually try to understand it in parts. You know, you would probably not look at the whole graph and, okay, this is what it is. It's not productive. It's not very clear, but, you know, it'll even represent things like variables as a node, which makes it not that useful, in my opinion. But anyway, the output generated by Terraform plan is very useful. many organizations have it. excuse me. Many organizations which rely heavily on infrastructure as code, they even commit the plan output to the repositories, so that you can always make sure that the actual infrastructure that's created somewhere matches the plan. You can always go back to that. Not what Terraform run initiates, but whatever is actually present in the infrastructure. The plan is supposed to represent that. And whenever you update your Terraform files, this plan will tell you that, okay, these are the things that needs to be changed. So at a code review level, for example, you can see that, okay, oh, it's going to delete this particular bucket. The change that I'm making in my Terraform, you may not realize that it's actually going to delete a bucket and create it again, or delete an EC2 instance and create it again. It may not appear. There are cases where Terraform has to do that, but you may not realize that it has to do that. Because, for example, certain attributes cannot be changed. So, like, for example, in that previous example that we saw, You might say that, okay, you just want to change the bucket name. But AWS S3, if I'm not wrong, it does not let you rename buckets. I could be wrong about that. But like, let's say, for example, there are certain things that AWS does not let you change. And the only way Terraform can continue with that is destroying the instance and creating it again. And you might not realize that that's going to happen by just reviewing this code, which is why reviewing the output of the plan and verifying that it is actually going to do what you want is important. So in that plan, it'll tell that, okay, it's going to delete this bucket and then recreate it. And if that's a problem for you, you have an opportunity to stop it. And then you have an option to execute the exact same plan. You know, so even if the Terraform script changes later, you have the plan output saved. Like I said, it can even be in version control, and you can run that same plan, not the script, not the modules again. In our case, we just ran the modules. It was, like I said, our application was not, our setup was not very, very complex. It was very straightforward. So we didn't really have this stage of reviewing the plan and verifying. Now, once you have the module set up or you have made a change to this module, you would run Terraform apply to actually start making these changes. And you would get an output, and you can verify that, like, you know, again, what you see in background, that's what it looks like. The first time you run Terraform apply, of course, that's when it's going to create everything. But if you make a change in a module and rerun it, it's only going to change what has actually changed. And Terraform is pretty flexible. It supports things like variables and, you can, not inherit, what's the word? You can use other dependent modules. And if anything changes in the graph, Terraform knows exactly what to change. It'll, like I said, idempotent. You know, it does not need to go through the whole thing again. And then, of course, test it, you know, that it works, that your infrastructure works. Like I mentioned in my previous session, you know, we had Terraform as part of our CI run. So as a CI run, you know, during CI, it would get the relevant Terraform module, run Terraform apply, and then it would verify that, okay, you know, the deployment works on that updated infrastructure. So let's get back to resources. Resources are like the basic block of what makes it a module, you know, and it represents some real world resource. We see this example, S3 bucket. You know, the other resources which are very common are EC2 instances, for example, or IAM permission, roles, or CloudFront distribution. So all of these are different resources. They have a single type that defines its behavior. In this case, the type is bucket. So we are creating a bucket over here. That's what it says. And resources may depend on other resources. So again, Terraform builds a whole dependency chain that, like for example, there are no dependencies here. But you might want that before a CloudFront distribution is created, you need to have that bucket first. You know, from the earlier graph, we saw that the bucket is the CloudFront distribution gets all its content from the bucket. So you need the bucket first and then the CloudFront distribution. So Terraform can, of course, do it in order. And the things which can be done in parallel, Terraform can do that in parallel. Next concept we need to know is providers. So there is not a single provider, right? It's not just AWS. We have Alion. In our case, we had Alion, but generally you have GCP or Azure or DigitalOcean, Linode, and like so many. Linode, I think that's, yeah. And so these are all implemented as providers. And your module needs to define this provider. What is the actual provider? You can have multiple ones. You know, you can have a single module which works with multiple providers. In my case, you know, and as a best practice, I would just have one provider per module, and like for example, AWS. And of course, you know, to work with AWS, you need these things: secret key, which region you want to work with, and this version is the version of the provider. It just says like 1.54. I think now if we you have, even have two, but yeah, it's like, you know, greater than or equal to 1.54. And then this block, it's so, you know, like I said, Terraform will be able to track all of these changes that it has created infrastructure previously. And you run it the next time, it knows that it's already created. It will not try to recreate it. So it has to store this somewhere, right? And by default, it stores it in the same, like, you know, from where you run it on your machine. Excuse me, on your machine where you run it, it stores as a state file, TF state file right over there. Of course, that doesn't work in a team environment. You know, in CI, for example, you can't have that TF state anywhere. And one of the best practices is that backend should be somewhere in a shared location, like S3 bucket. So this in this module, for example, I specified that the backend should be S3. And actually, it's I'm not extending that over here. Like, I'm not showing that over here, but you need to define what bucket and which path is the TF state stored. In my case, like I said, you know, we had like 24 different websites, which means we had like 24 different states. So we had this whole system of, you know, all this for each cloud and each site, each environment, we have a different TF state file. By default, if you don't specify this backend S3, it's stored as a TF state file on your machine, and you need to keep that. I mean, if you're interested in keeping your infrastructure current, yeah, you need to keep that. But it's not a good idea to commit that to your version control, because it stores the TF state file stores secrets. Yeah, providers, like I said, offers a set of resources. So AWS has its own resources, S3 bucket, and all that. Alloy has its own set of resources. You know, so it's not like that. You create one module and it works for all providers. You have to have. I mean, like, maybe one day we'll have. I don't know, but right now, yeah, you for each provider you need to write a different module. Basically, whatever infrastructure you're planning to build, for each provider you need to change the module. And they have their own configuration, like we discussed. State is where the Terraform stores information about the infrastructure. This is how it finds out that, okay, there is a change. And it's local by default, but can be stored remotely, like I said in this example. So one of the ways, again, you know, when you're running it in CI, where you are, like, of course, you can't have, like, the bucket name could be different. The table name could be different and all that. So again, you can put it in different file, like, for example, backend.tfwhat. So Terraform will load this file automatically and make all of these available as variables. So which, you know, brings us to variables. They are parameters, so you can define as many variables as you would like. And you know, the things that you don't define a default, like you can define a default as well, like name prefix, for example. You know, so name prefix we use, you know, S3 buckets have to be globally unique. You can't have two buckets which have the same exact name anywhere. So we added a prefix for all of our buckets so that there is no chance of collision. Then the base protocol, like default is HTTP. And now all of these variables, you can override that using the tfwhats files, which we saw earlier, or using from the command line. When you're initiating Terraform apply, you can specify the values of these variables. Yeah, typically named variables.tf, but it doesn't matter. Again, Terraform, we'll look at the file, like, you know, how this all these files are stored. And we'll look at how this all files are stored, and Terraform typically reads all of those files. So one of the things that I did over here was creating a wrapper script that sets all of these variables. And it's a common practice. It's not unheard of that you would not directly invoke Terraform apply. The command gets really long, like Terraform apply and variable file name or additional variables. We just had a wrapper script which we would run by CI, and it will take care of setting the correct variables as it should. There are multiple ways, like I said, you know, you one of the ways is to even use environment variables. CLI environment variables or a variable file. You can put all the variables in a file and then pass it using a command line option. And when I say module, it's nothing special about that. It's just a bunch of TF files in the same directory. When you run Terraform apply in this directory, it reads all of these TF files, loads it, and executes it builds a plan from whatever resources it can find over here. At the same time, it will resolve all the variables, and you can also load like other variables like backend.tf_vars, for example. You can load all of that. Now, there is no real convention, so at least I have not found a real convention, except that typically each of these modules have a main.tf file. That's the only convention I could find. Then you're completely free. In my case, I split the Terraform files based on the resource. So there was like API gateway.tf. So all the resources that are related to API gateway are there. And the example that I gave about S3 bucket, that was rather simple. But for certain resources, the examples get really complicated. For example, API gateway is not just the gateway itself. But API gateway has an endpoint, and then there are like methods for each endpoint, and then like there are proxies and all that. So all of those are implemented as separate resources, and all of them are in this file. And similarly, there are different files, for CloudFront one, output, it's just something, so whenever you run Terraform apply, at the end, of course, there are a lot of resources that it created, and you can get attributes of all of these resources, you create an EC2 instance, for example, and you need to know the machine name that got generated. So if you want to find that machine name, you can read that attribute later. But if you want to make it simple, you can use this directive called output, which will just at the end of the script will tell you that, okay, that this is one of the outputs from your script. Variables and WebHTML, these are just the name. Basically, the point is the names can be anything. And then the wrapper script, sets variables correctly depending on the task. Like you saw, there can be a lot of variables, and one variable which is not set correctly could create unpredictable consequences. Of course you have planned everything, but then a wrapper script makes sure that that the mistakes are minimum. Like I said earlier, automate, because it's very easy for people to make these mistakes. Initialize the correct remote state backend. In our case, we had 24, 28, 36 different environments we were targeting. We didn't want to deploy one side to something else, another bucket. It would have been embarrassing, to say the least. So of course, initialize the correct remote state backend. So if you are deploying to site one, the bucket name gets site one dev. It sets all the variables that have to be set for site one dev, the bucket name and the CloudFront distribution name and everything. And then it little bit of validation also before passing it on to Terraform. So you can't, for example, our branches were very specifically named dev, dev one, QA, and dev, dev one stage and production. You can't use any other. So whatever you can validate before sending it on to Terraform. We already saw this in the last session, but in case someone's new, we would run Terraform on every push. So whenever someone would make a change to one of the front-end applications, Jenkins would, apart from other things, the building of the front-end application itself, it would also invoke Terraform. And this was important initially because we changed the architecture. We discovered things that didn't work, or the requirements change, and it was important to do it initially because we couldn't make sure that those changes got rolled out to all the 24 of those websites or 24 of those environments. But eventually we could remove it. We didn't need to keep the script in. And like I said before, running it in CI requires that you use a remote state. You can't do it without that. So one of we had a lot of learnings. One of the things that defined this project for us was how hectic it was. We built well, not just this pipeline, we kind of, I think the entire pipeline, we built it over a month, but the entire project was around 3 or 4 months long, which was, it was really hectic. So what helped us was not tools, you know, I said this in previous the previous presentation as well. You know, it's not tools that makes DevOps. It's the people, it's the culture. So one of the things that I keep telling about decoupled Drupal implementations is not the technology, it's the teams that define it. And it's, for example, you know, you may need, I think I'm coming to those points. So one of the things that you need to do is build an API definition, an API contract that both the teams agree to. Okay. And this was important because the teams work in their own pace. The benefit of decoupled is that, okay, the technologies, that benefit is there, of course, but the benefit is that the front-end team and the back-end team can move at their own pace. They don't have to be locked in the same sprint. They don't even have to have an overlapping sprint, you know. You could definitely have like a front-end team working on a sprint of 2 weeks and the Drupal team working on a sprint of 3 weeks, depending on what works for your application. As long as the API contract is there, the communication is there between the teams, it works. Another thing is that, you know, we knew that we had to implement infrastructure as code. But it was difficult to sell it to an organization, like I said, which is a large hospitality player, which has been around for years. It's difficult to sell them on the whole process because, again, it's not about tools, it's about the culture. If the organization doesn't recognize that that the entire team, not just one person, not just the team lead or one team adopting certain set of tools, if the organization does not identify that, it's very difficult to make efficient use of all of these tools. It doesn't help if only one person is if only one of the sites use Terraform and the other sites they are building it by hand. It doesn't work. It doesn't help anyone because the second site will definitely lag behind the other sites. And another learning is that not all providers are created equal. Terraform is an open source project. All the providers are open source, so it depends on volunteers mainly. You know, those volunteers who are maintaining each particular implementation. Now, something as popular as AWS, that's of course immediately updated. Any product they add, you know, I think next day you would have a provider for that. But for something like Alium, it was surprising really that there was no Terraform support for certain things that we wanted to do in Alium. But even the Alium CLI did not have that support, which was really weird for me. And even the Alium API, in fact, we even considered writing a script, the Alium CLI does not support that particular feature, which is there on their website. It doesn't support that feature. Let's make an API call directly. But even that was not working. So these kind of things do come up. Fortunately, if you're working with things like, you know, AWS mainly, then you don't need to be worried. The providers stay up to date. The API stays up to date. Again, it's really about the communication. It's the API communication. One of the ways you formalize the communication between two different teams is API contract. If you're building a decoupled website, I would strongly suggest get to that first. Build a contract and get the buy-in from both teams, the front-end team and the back-end team, to fulfill that contract that, okay, if anything changes, the communication, they know how to communicate. And that's the only way you can have a successful decoupled project, not any of these tools. So here are a few resources. You're welcome. And you're welcome to find more information about Terraform, HCL, any of these from these links. You can find me at hussainweb pretty much everywhere. Twitter mainly, I'm active on Twitter, and that's it. Any questions? Yes, please. Yeah.
I'm curious, how do you manage your secrets in Terraform? For example, AWS keys and things like that. For example, a tool like Ansible has the vault service that lets you encrypt your keys and your things like that. But from my research, I couldn't find anything on Terraform, or maybe I just missed it. I'm just curious, how do you manage those secrets? Because it's very important to keep those things safe.
Yeah.
So,
one of the problems with Terraform is that the secrets get stored in state. And that's why I said that, okay, you know, you would commit your plan output, but do not commit your state. But the good thing is that that's the only file that you need to worry about keeping it safe. Now, there are two parts of the secret management. One is the input of secrets, like, you know, getting the secrets to Terraform. And their vault is possible. One of the ways is variables, of course, you know, so at least in the CI process, we injected those secrets, if you remember from the previous session, for using Jenkins, which stores secrets securely, we injected it from Jenkins to the CI where it ran, and then, of course, you know, it took it from there, you know, Terraform took it from there, and like I said, it stores it in state. If you do not want to use Jenkins, or if you're using something else, you can use Vault, definitely, that's one thing. But that, even if you use Vault over there, you still have to worry about secrets that get stored in state file, which means that the wherever you're storing your state, that has to be secure. Locally, of course, it is secure, but it's not safe, right? Safe as in, you know, you can lose your laptop, right? So you have to, like, you have to find a place where you can store it securely. We went with S3 bucket, which was completely locked down, like from all AWS permissions and all that. Still not the best way to secure a state file. I'm not really considered any alternative, but it would be great, like, you know, you can just store the state file in Vault, for example, and let Terraform query it from Vault every time. I didn't really explore that.
Yeah, I consider Terraform to be great, but when it comes to the secret management, I find it a bit lacking.
Yes,
for example, with Ansible, you have the vault, which does the job for you, and you can just safely store, and it just encrypts the secrets for you, and you can use it without having any issues. With this one, it's a bit different because you can't really do that. So
yeah.
You need to think in advance of how I'm going to deal with my secrets, which is very important.
It's very important.
It's especially with AWS, because Terraform will need to have loads of permission to be able to build those that infrastructure for itself.
Yeah. So the thing is, I know Terraform, like, again, this is at that time when I was building this. They might have already made these improvements by now. But I know that they were looking for better ways of storing secrets in the state file, specifically not storing secrets when it doesn't need to. Like, for example, AWS key doesn't really need to store that, but it used to. At that point of time, it used to. I don't know, maybe by now they've already updated it to not store those secrets. Some secrets it still needs to store, right? Which means your state file is still important, but something like, you know, your AWS key, access key, it may not be storing it in state file anyway at this point. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? All right, so like I said, any questions, anything you want to talk about, you can find me at hussainweb, or, you know, for the rest of the day, tomorrow probably. And thank you, everyone.